You mentioned that you love working with the orchestra.
Yes.
Why is that?
In my head, I love the sound of the orchestra, right? You know, what it has to offer, the multitude of colors that it has to offer. Of course, orchestras are the largest collection of performing musicians that one has at their disposal. You know, add a choir to it, you can have on the stage, as I have on occasion, over 100 people, you know, 120, whatever. It can get pretty massive, the number of people contributing to it. So just the power of the number of people connected to the manifestation of this idea you have is a killer. I mean, the vibrancy of having all these people working collectively together to try to accomplish a piece of music, that you can have such a diversity of sonorities, you know. And certainly in horror films, there's a wonderful resource there to get hardcore drama, you know, in a way that you could never out of a solo guitar. You know, write a romantic movie, you know, a period drama, whatever, doing something on guitar, you know, or something out in the West. I could, you know, get out a dobro or a something, you know, a 12-string guitar, and we're set. But with, you know, horror films, suspense thrillers, sometimes the orchestra is the thing that provides the kind of intense dramatic energy. That kind, particular type of intense dramatic energy that no other single instrument could possibly get, or not even a small collection of instruments could possibly get. So it happened that I was, when I moved out here, I had an idea in my head, because I just finished, I was a student at North Texas State University in Denton, Texas. I'd applied to UCLA and USC, because I knew I had to go back to school. I finished college on the East Coast, thought I was ready to look to make it. I'd fallen in love with film music, but in a very short period of time after living in New York City, I realized, guess what? You don't know crap. You better go back to school and really start studying how to write for the orchestra. Applied to UCLA, USC, they turned me down, went to North Texas State University. I had the great advantage of studying with two pioneers in the world of electronic music. Larry Austin, who himself had been a student at North Texas, lived in California for years, was a part of the avant-garde movement out here, then ended up going back to North Texas as a faculty. And my first classes in electronic music were with him, and they were like so eye-opening. Again, in those days, no one had home studios, of course. The equipment was so expensive. You had to book time in the electronic music lab at the university to utilize what instruments they had there. Now, they had the Moog, they had an arp, and a Buchla. Now, the Buchla was his instrument, and so that's kind of what I spent time with trying to understand through his tutelage. But my favorite of all favorites was the analog Moog, and you know, the cording stuff. And Merrill Ellis was the other composer, electronic music specialist there, who was also mentioned in any book on electronic music, history of electronic music. He taught there. One of my biggest initial highs was, there I am during my time, you know, my book time, and I'm making, I for some reason really quickly felt like I understand the Moog. And I started using the patch bay and would come up with these pretty cool sounds. And I'm kind of like, wow, I'm digging this, Chris, you know. And I remember getting a knock on the door once. This is when I was pretty new at it. And I opened the door, and there's Merrill Ellis, and he looked like Santa Claus. And he said, what's your name? I was shaking because I knew the great Merrill Ellis. I said, whoa. He goes, Chris, just want to let you know, I heard this as I was walking down the hall, and I went, holy moly, that is pretty wild. And so that was my first, you know, sort of vote of approval from someone who knew this world really well. Now,
those things mean a lot in the early state of a career for a lot of people, I think.
What's that again?
The vote of confidence by someone.
Oh, God, that's so critical. And I teach at USC, you know, and that's my thing, is that, you know, I make a point of insisting that no composer walks out of my room without feeling a little bit better about themselves. You know, film music has changed so dramatically since when I moved out here. When I moved out here, if you didn't know how to write for the orchestra, and remember, it meant putting notes on paper, you know, doing sketches, or if you didn't have the money for an orchestrator, which I didn't, you had to be able to write out the full orchestra score, taking care of all the instruments. If you couldn't do that, you were a phony. They used to call them hummers. That word is gone now, but the worst curse that could befall on you as an aspiring film composer, that guy's nothing but a hummer. A hummer was someone who didn't know how to do that, so they'd have to sit at the piano and hum their tune to someone who could put it on paper for them. Of course, the great example of someone who hummed his way into history was Charles Chaplin. Charles Chaplin was responsible for coming up with the musical ideas for all of his movies. I think all of his movies. But at least the composer I studied with when I moved out here at UCLA, who changed my life by giving me that vote of approval right at the time where I was crying every day and ready to quit, was David Raxon. And David Raxon wrote the music for Laura, Forever Amber, The Bad and the Beautiful, and about 95 other movies, and lots of television. I gotta tell you, I was so lucky that when I moved out here, I went to UCLA. Even if a student wanted to have original music for his movie, we had to find money to get live musicians into the little recording studio at Melnitz Hall, which is the film department over there. And so everything I did way in the early days, it's all live. Was all live, all real musicians. And I just thank my lucky stars I caught the tail end of that, you know. Because I had to, you know, as everyone did, then you had to know how to write for the instrument. You really did, because someone was going to play it. And if you screwed it up and you wrote for the flute in a register that no flute on this planet, even a bass flute, could play, then you were in trouble, you know. You look like a fool, and there was no time. The students didn't have, they would, you know, pay minimal amount of money to get other students from the music department over there. You know what I mean? So that all worked in the best of ways.